welcome. If you'd like to make or ask a question, you can raise your hand.
Love and care and concern and compassion. He's so happy that he's alive today. Okay, this might be another question for Kevin.
In states that do have legalized assisted suicide, have there been challenges in the Supreme Court in view of the decision of 1997?
There have not. There have not.
And I'm wondering why not.
That's a good point. I don't know why not. I honestly don't know the answer to that question. But there have not.
And in view of what's been happening lately, other end of legalized killing, that is abortion, making it a requirement for certain hospitals and insurance plans to cover that, it appears that if this law became law, one step would be to censor doctors who refuse on religious or any other grounds to provide assisted suicide, possibly to penalize them, to either financially or imprison them. All these things are now happening to those few institutions who absolutely refuse to participate in
Yes, that's an excellent point, and one that I didn't bring up, but there are some conscience protections within these bills that supposedly protect the consciences of healthcare persons, providers, doctors, nurses, and other personnel, as well as hospitals, like Catholic hospitals or nursing homes that don't want to participate in this. We find our attorneys who have looked at these bills line by line, taken them apart, and you can find our legal analysis. They find those conscience protections extremely weak, and they really wouldn't, one of the bills in particular, really wouldn't protect Catholic institutions, nursing homes, hospices, hospitals, that don't want to take part in this at all. They really don't protect them at all. The bills say that hospitals can say that their physicians can't prescribe these medications on the hospital ground, but if they go across the street to their own practice, sure, they can do what they want at their own practice over there. So there are some pretty weak conscience protections in the bill, and I feel, as the last question did, you know, I keep encouraging young people with solid moral values to go into the healthcare profession, because we need people with solid principles and grounding in our faith to go into the healthcare profession. We really do.
I'm Kathy Sowers, I'm a first year parent.
And the lector tonight.
That is true. Trying to figure out how to phrase my question. You mentioned the other states that now have this procedure as legal, and you also cited that the American Medical Association does not have a statement that supports this. Do those state medical associations, have they changed their stand did that have an influence in the process? So in other words, where are we in New York in the process of this coming to the floor? How many things need to fall?
There's two questions there, I think. First one, great question, because yes, the American Medical Association opposes this. Yes, the California Medical Association used to oppose this. And then, last year, they withdrew their opposition. Under heavy pressure from Compassionate Choices advocates and lobbyists, they withdrew their opposition and went to a neutral position in the state of California. And I believe that was really the green light that gave lawmakers permission to vote this in. That's what legalized it. When the California Medical Association withdrew their opposition, I think the legislators felt free. That's why I say it's so important for us to be talking to our doctors to make sure that the medical society in the state of New York stays where it is. In September of 2015, at a board meeting, the Medical Society of the State of New York, representing New York State physicians, reaffirmed their opposition to physician-assisted suicide in even stronger language than they had in the past, so I was very grateful for that. But we have to make sure our medical society stays there, because I believe that's what ushered it in California. That and Britain, our story, certainly. Second question, where are we in the legislative process? Well, the bills have been introduced and are sitting in the health committees of each House, in the Senate Health Committee and the Assembly Health Committee. They've not gotten considered yet, so we are focusing our attention on the health committee members. Senator Betty Little is a health committee member, so she's very important to talk to about this issue. So the first step would be committee votes. I'm not sure they're going to receive committee votes this year. I'm not sure that our opponents have rounded up those votes yet. I don't think they have. It's also an election year where all 213 legislators are up for election, re-election. They usually don't like to touch thorny, controversial issues in an election year. And also, this is New York. I mean, we are the most dysfunctional state legislature in the country, officially. And it's been an odd legislative session. So we're hoping that it doesn't come to a floor vote or committee vote or a floor vote this year.
The doctors who took the original Hippocratic oath, are they still able to stand by their oath, or do they have to succumb to the new wording?
Oh, I think they're able to stand by the oath. The doctors who are taking the traditional oath. Yeah, because I mean, I know many of them. We have many doctors who are helping us in this battle, and they firmly believe in the traditional Hippocratic oath. There's a question over there. I'm near the microphone. Is that okay?
Well, I'll come over there.
Oh, okay.
You better stand next to the camera.
Yeah, it's easy. I can get there. So, I'm George Crocker, and my credentials are, I've worked here for 40 years as a pediatrician and family physician, and now I'm medical director of hospice, medical director of palliative care. My wife is from the Netherlands, and I'm very interested in medical ethics, and I will tell everyone here that I think physician-assisted suicide has five major problems at this moment in New York State. One, it's clumsy.
There's a question.
I have a question. We're going to have lunch on time. I know how important that is. But I have to frame this because there have been problems. I think it's clumsy. I think that it is theatrical. I think that it has immediate consequences for family members if they're not all absolutely on board. I think that it has long-term consequences for families if my daughter falls in love with John's son, and it's the Hatfield and the McCoys. And I also think that it is so new in New York State that those who first choose to do this better be very wise about it. So, my personal feeling is that I would never do this myself. I would never choose ever to have physician-assisted suicide. And I would never, ever say to someone, I think physician-assisted suicide is a good idea for you, but I do believe in choice. Now, here is my question. I had to just give you my background, okay? My question is this. It's about the difference between withholding and withdrawing therapies. And just last week, I spoke with someone, and so my question is about the Catholic theology. And again, I am not representing any of these organizations of which I am part, and I want everyone to understand this is just me speaking. Hospice doesn't need me up here. The hospital doesn't need me up here. I work for them in other ways. But my question is this. Someone who works at the hospital told me that their father was dying from multiple reasons, multiple organ system failure, and was on dialysis. He chose, near the end of his life, to withhold further, or withdraw, excuse me, to withdraw his dialysis therapy. His suffering, his personal suffering, in his mind's eye, was worse than the benefit of that dialysis. Now, I think it was a rogue priest who told him that he would be committing suicide and would go to hell. And that rogue priest, I do believe, told his family the same thing. He tried to block the Catholic communion and burial for this patient. Please tell me, and I couldn't figure out from your slide, please tell me the Catholic Church's stance on a situation like this, because I'm of the feeling that it was such extreme paternalism on the part of that priest to not really allow this patient's personal choice. I'm a choice person. I hate abortion. I don't like physician-assisted suicide or the idea of it, but I'm a choice person. What is the Catholic Church's feeling about that withdrawal of treatment?
Well, without knowing it, the doctor has actually brought us into the afternoon session where we are going to, I don't know if you're able to stay or not, doctor, but that's exactly what we're going to talk about. The difference between euthanasia and foregoing overly aggressive medical interventions, which may be morally permissible under Catholic teaching. And I think you know more than you're letting on, because you've used language like burdens and benefits, which are absolutely essential for us to understand, and that's what we're going to learn about this afternoon. End-of-life decision-making, burdens, benefits, ordinary, extraordinary treatments, all of that are going to unfold for you, so you will understand that there is a big difference between giving someone lethal drugs to hasten and bring about the moment of death, and withdrawing or withholding overly aggressive medical interventions.
Okay, well, I was of the feeling that that was the Catholic theological position, but I really couldn't tell that.
Well, that's just my slides this afternoon.
Okay, great. Thank you. Very much.
But the question I have is,
write any protections in this kind of a law, because it's a bad law to begin with. You really can't protect against the expansion of the law. That's another great story, even though it's not a good story. But still, your witness, your understanding of what happened to your family member, that's so important for you to get out there so people understand that this is real in other countries. This is happening. Thank you. Are we ready for lunch now?
Are there any other questions? I know some of you won't be staying for the afternoon session. Some of our priests who are here, so busy, Father Phil Allen, Mr. McElroy, Father Nemo, Pastor Father Adam, their head won't be ready for Bob Sunday this afternoon. So again, Father, thanks for joining us. And I know some others won't be able to make it either. So I wanted to make a formal thank you now, although the larger group is here, to thank Kathy for coming today, all the way from Albany.